This is our paranormal podcast because this is our paranormal community, and we want to support you here on RU Media Network. We are proud to be sponsored by the Haunted Hinsdale House in Hinsdale, New York. Here are your hosts, Brian Mersal and Sean Gilmore.
Wait a minute. Did I do the wrong intro?
No. You want to do it again?
I feel so out of it. Like, I've had such a busy weekend. Like, I feel like that. Was that the right intro? It was? Okay. Man.
I loved it.
All right. I didn't mess up. Score. So, sorry about that, guys. It's been, like, crazy. Summer has begun. And the Gilmore House it's a madhouse. It's insane. And the pun is totally intended because it's, like I said, insane. So I'm tired. So, but I'm glad to be here. Two really good friends of both mine and Brian, yes, from our haunted minds, RU Media Network, and Resident Undead crew, and the list goes on and on. Eric McGill and David Wooliver. How are you guys doing?
Just fine. That's a long list now that I hear it out loud.
Yeah, it is. How do we get anything done?
I have no idea.
It's great anymore to be here. Thanks for having us, guys.
Of course.
No problem. No problem. Of course. I don't have a whole lot of house cleaning to do, so we can just like dive in today, guys.
Yes.
I watched your guys' new documentary last night on my TV, and you guys had some of the craziest experiences. And this location you guys are at, I've only been there once. That makes me want to go back again. I know when Brian was there, he and his team had some crazy stuff go on. We'll talk about that later so you guys can compare notes. You guys do a really cool experiment on it. I know we don't want to give too much away, but that's kind of what you guys do, right? You guys come up with these experiments, mm-hmm, and you kind of test the theory on them.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And you guys seem to get, I mean, you guys had so much activity. It's insane.
Yeah. When we first got there, Dave will attest to this. We weren't getting jack. It was terrible
at all.
We walked around for 2-3 hours. I forget. I have all the videos, so I just added everything up with the amount of footage that we recorded, and maybe added a couple of fluffer minutes here and there for me and Dave to complain to one another. But we weren't getting anything, and we were having technical issues, which we didn't really touch too much on in the video. And a lot of our plans that we had made getting there early on, we had like this big grand plan to do a daytime investigation and see what happened. Well, we didn't get nothing. It backfired on us. So coming into it, we were, I don't know about Dave, but I was feeling whipped and a little like, what the heck is going on? That was my whole demeanor, you know, at beginning of day one. What the crap?
I think going back to when we actually filmed it, we were only a week removed having just filmed Resident Undead's return there also. And we came back around the next weekend and filmed our episode. So it was kind of a little bit of a disadvantage going into it, but we made it work, man.
Yeah, I mean, whenever we got to that stage where I had literally just, I had talked to Dave, and this was off camera again, I said, I don't have any more ideas. Everything I try fails. Everything we're trying, it's just not working. I said, man, maybe we ought to just pack it in for the night because it's not going to get better. And then he off camera, he came to me, as Dave does, and he said, well, calm down before
we... Wait, let me show you how Eric. How I was talking to Eric. Hold on. There you go.
All right.
And I was looking up like this. But he did. He calmed me down and he said, let's call Adam and Becca and see if they can maybe send somebody or if they're in the area. Maybe they'll come out and help us. Because we knew that they were there close by. We knew that much, but we had no idea what was going to happen. So everything in the video, just minus a few F-bombs and whatever else Dave and I threw at each other, that's all in there. Yeah. But it was very grim at first. And unlike Fairfield County Infirmary to not give you something, we were fighting the whole way, the whole time. Just that bit in the beginning. Just that bit in the beginning.
Yeah.
That gets frustrating when you're investigating and you're not getting anything.
Let me just say, though, I paid an extensive amount for, I'm not going to say how much, but it was a lot for those camera harnesses. They were especially, I modified those. There was a lot of thought put into those.
Yeah.
Something we didn't talk about. Dave knows how much I spent. I took that mother effer and I broke it. I was so mad.
They ended up in the dumpster.
Yep.
Oh.
I was furious.
Well, I have an idea. Next time you want to spend a lot of money on a piece of equipment that doesn't work, you could just mail me a check. I'll send you my
address. Well, I would have rather burnt it.
I'll spend it on you. I'll buy you a nice gift.
It very well could have been, Peggy. And hello and thank you for everything. Yeah. As usual, Peggy.
It definitely could have been. Yeah, especially there. Now, kind of stepping away from the paranormal side of that location. For me, when I was there, there is one thing that kept on happening. And the upstairs in the dungeon attic area, the chicken coop, I would hit my head on that dang door. On the top of that doorway. How many times
did you guys? How do you think I feel?
I know you're tall.
I hit my collarbones on
that. Yeah.
So yeah, I always gotta bring up that doorway.
I can kind of limbo underneath of it though.
And I actually have a dent in my shin. There's a, I don't know if it was like an anvil or what it was. It was some sort of cast iron something on the other end of the dungeon area. And it's literally dented my bone. It's still kind of dented.
Ooh. I'm
joking. That was like 2 years ago. So that's what happens when you walk around in the dark and you're the guy that always forgets his flashlight. So.
Yeah.
Don't be that guy.
No, I don't want to be that guy. But to be honest with you, I'd prefer that over all the tech issues we had initially. Not to take away from your pain, but... I'd have literally let somebody kick me right in the crotch before I'd go through that again willingly.
That's so hard though.
Yeah, right? I've never quite seen Eric quite that wild.
Oh, yeah. I was mad.
It's tough though, especially when you invest so much money into your equipment and then you get it excited to use it, and then when you go to use it, it's not cooperating and not doing what you need it to do.
Well, it was a lot, though. It was Dave was there. We had set aside the time to do this investigation. You know, everybody else goes in there and has just the best, you know, experiences, and they get the best activity. And, I mean, we weren't doing anything special, I'll admit. We were just kind of doing our standard run-of-the-mill EVP sessions. But I figured that's where it would shine, you know, and just initially – I don't know if maybe it was our energies or whatever it was. It just it didn't work out for us that well.
We may have been pushing things back and away with our frustration.
And you know what? I believe that's happened with me before. You get frustrated or get in an argument or that negativity. I mean, it doesn't make you approachable, right? And then plus, when you're in that kind of mood, you don't want to be approachable.
Mm-hmm.
Whether if it's by spirit or by a person. I know me, when I'm in a pissed off mood, I should say, I got to force myself to talk to people. That's the last thing I want to be doing. I want to be by myself and center myself.
Well, I'm just glad that, you know, everything kind of picked up. We got our second win, and I will try to keep that in mind the next time I decide I want to smash a camera or something, but... everything kind of just turned around, right when we decided to do our first experiment of the night, that's when things just it was like you could feel the difference. I'll say that. Mm,
yeah.
It was really it was a really big turning point.
Yeah, that place
lit. Both felt it.
That place lit up like the 4th of July after that.
Yeah. Nice. Did you guys ever go up into the tower and like look around the campus area?
If I could fit up the stairs, yeah.
Oh yeah.
I could probably fit up there, but I think Adam told me you don't want to go up there.
Yep.
I said okay.
You're either gonna go through it or get smacked in the face with a bird.
Well, so what I did was I like banged on the side, like before I went up to make sure that no bats would come. But like I just went up to the top step. I went to the top of the landing. I didn't walk around it a lot because I figured that there might be something messy. So I just kind of looked. I just wanted to look out and see the moon and all that stuff.
I think it's still structural. Most of the time the bats aren't in there, and it's just like the blackbirds and sparrows that randomly get in somehow.
Yeah.
And they think going up there will get them out, and nope.
Oh, yeah. It's because of the windows. They see the sunlight.
Yeah, I think the reason why Adam said for me not to go up there is because of the birds and because of the smell, but I don't remember off the top of my head. It smells like birds and feathers up there. If that could be a smell.
It could be. It could be. I've been in places with birds and bird shit everywhere.
I think that's where the epicenter of that that nasty smell would be, if there is one.
No. I don't know. I don't remember. It was a little while ago when I was there.
Me too.
Summer before. Brian and his team, they went there.
Mm-hmm.
And they had some crazy stuff happen. Can you tell us a little bit about that, Brian?
Yeah, I mean, it was the same scenario. Like, our team, like, our half of the team was hearing weird, loud bangs on, like, the second and third floor. Like, odd. And then the other team wasn't experiencing as much. So it was extremely similar to you. Like, the worst thing that could happen on an investigation as a team leader is like a dud. That's just, you know, being honest. So I took my team up to the top floor, and we gathered in a circle, and, you know, we were just saying, you know, just almost all together, like closing our eyes and really trying to communicate with the spirits and good positive energies, because I could see that people were getting a little frustrated and, you know, a little down. We found some bells. We were ringing some bells. We were doing some weird stuff, all the stuff I thought of on the fly. And of course, after that, it kind of gave enough energy. So sometimes you don't even need to know what you're saying. Obviously, it's not like weird culty stuff, but just actually like trying to channel, you know, your energies and trying to make a meaningful, connection. But yeah, that's what we did. So our story was pretty similar to yours.
So you started off slow, but then you did get stuff to kind of interact with you later on in the night.
Yeah, it was interesting because my portion of the team kind of got those weird noises, but not too much. The other team was kind of like what you and Dave were experiencing, you know, not very much anything. And then after we did that, it was, you know, dolls were falling over on camera and people were hearing stuff, getting touched, you know, all this weird. They said, yes, please. Mm-hmm. And, you know, as soon as that doll fell, I mean, everyone was freaking out about it because they got it on camera. And, you know, after that, you know, they're like, they're putting so much energy in there. And we even did, it was like, it was so big when we got there. I said, I don't know how we're going to do it, but we're going to do haunted hide and seek. I don't know how we're going to do it. We're going to do it. And I think I had like three people that had never been on investigation before. And it was like peak after the doll and people are getting touched and stuff. And people were giddy. And so they all spread out and, you know, they're excited. They're going to go hide somewhere. And then reality set in. I'm in a closet. There's three mirrors in this room. And this is actually this is a great hiding spot. But this is the room that Jerry got touched in. And I don't feel safe anymore. Like, the adrenaline wore off. And it was a pretty exciting night.
So y'all picked a hell of a place to play hide and seek.
Oh, yeah. I know. It was beautiful. I was actually seeking because it was more
Wait
of
a minute. Did you? Oh no, you guys. What did you guys investigate there, Eric and David?
Oh, shortly after Adam actually. Well, no, I can't say that. It was 2020 sometime. It was during a pandemic.
Okay.
So this was like
June of that year.
Adam had just gotten it in February.
So then, Brian, what made you guys think of the idea of playing hide and seek?
I don't know. I'm weird. It was such a big place. we were looking at all these rooms, and I said, I've actually got, because our group has maybe like 30, 40 people, off and on. And the group was extremely solid. And, when you got like a rock star group, I said, we're going to make some magic happen. I said, I don't care how we like figure the itinerary. We're going to do this.
But that's really cool.
But didn't you guys get an EVP or something on your investigation that mentioned something about hide and seek?
Yeah, through the Phasma box, I think.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, we did.
That was more directed at Adam, I think. When they when we filmed there before our haunted mines, Adam had a really cool interaction with a little kid surrounding like one of the wheelchairs, and he wanted to race and play hide and seek. Like, it was a whole thing that Adam had this connection with a little kid.
I still that's still kind of like that idea, Brian. You got that idea. That idea came to you somehow, some way. It's connected.
It was only after the tour, so I had been there, and
somebody gave you that idea, man. That I think maybe so. You're more sensitive than what you think.
Maybe. That would be cool. That'd be cool to kind of. I don't know if you can investigate that or look into that, but that is kind of a neat thought.
Yeah.
I don't, I mean, it could just be like secret, some sort of synchronicity, or, it could just be, circumstance, but still.
Could be.
Yeah, I mean, we walked through the whole place. Weird. So.
But it is interesting that maybe there is a presence there that likes that sort of game, and you would come through and pick up on that potentially.
Just strange. Yeah, I mean, that's the only place that I've done 50 plus, which is not like rock star numbers, but that's the only time I thought of it. So that is ironic or coincidental. One of the two.
We like the idea. We might steal that one too.
Please. Yeah. I take it. It's all yours.
I don't know the logistics of it, but I just love it. I don't know how to do it.
So Eric and I are going to go to like OSR or like Moundsville. And I'm going to hide. Good luck, Eric.
What
if I purposely don't find you?
See you in the morning.
Well, here it is. You put cash money on it, and there's a timer, and then you see who can last the longest. That's how you do it.
I'm winning that for sure. Big man knows how to hide.
Yeah. Oh, man.
Like this, I mean, if you go to OSR, it's just, whoever loses has to pay the bill to...
Yikes. Yeah, exactly. Nobody wants to lose that.
Oh, no.
So...
That's funny. Yeah, sorry.
No, man, I like that idea, though. There's got to be some way to do that. That would be really cool for, like, some type of experiment. Something we got to think about, Dave.
Yeah. Actually, yeah, I just had some random blips of it going through my brain. So,
like, how cool is it? I love that idea. I mean, I always have a deck of cards in my backpack, because if it's a slow night, you sit there and play some cards. I mean, that can gain interaction. I mean, Eric, remember when we did the Kent stage? We were just sitting. We didn't even know we were getting interaction. We thought it was a dead night. We were in the lower level. And as soon as we got up and left, we got an interaction of a spirit. It sounded like it got frustrated with us because we weren't able to catch on. It was trying to talk to us. I mean, that's sometimes when you get the best interaction, you're just sitting there.
Yeah, I remember that.
Doing whatever.
Yeah. That's the one that dropped the F-bomb, wasn't it?
Yes, it is.
Yes, I remember that.
Yes, it is. And so the Fairfield is also has a big event coming, right?
Yes, it does. Mm-hmm. I knew you were going to ask.
Of course.
Still didn't pull it up to be ready for it.
Oh, well, I've got a poster here.
There you go.
I don't have any links or anything, but it's this Saturday. Yeah. I didn't realize that.
Came up really fast.
Really fast. Really fast. And I actually found this here as I was trying to find something to share for this event. And this is what I found.
Here we go.
Bahal.
Oh, hold on. I have the sound turned off. Sorry about that. She said, take it slow, put it down on me. It's a jump on it, ride like a pony. Face down low, time to get naughty. Face down low, time to get naughty. Take it slow, put it down on me. Baby, jump on it, ride like a pony. Face down low, time to get naughty. Face down low, face down low. And we gon' get it on. I do not own the rights to that music. I think that's from a TikTok.
Facebook doesn't care. They'll still ding it.
I know. They killed us last time because I played this. I played a video that I thought was funny. And
getting flagged.
I know.
For work a few years ago, I work at a local access TV station where I'm from. And we were covering a high school girls' softball game for the community, and the girls wanted at-bat music, so each of them got their own music as they came up. And one of them had Smash Mouth's All-Star, and the 12 seconds that they played of that was enough to make Facebook completely shut our live feed of the game off and have to start it again.
Oh, wow.
So, yeah. Facebook and me are not friends lately.
Facebook, I don't want to say that. I wish that there was a different platform that everyone used. I'll say that.
There used to be MySpace.
I know. Yeah, I totally miss MySpace. Dude, with MySpace, you could like totally customize your page, get like different wallpapers, like the whole wallpaper. That's part of it. That's a little thing. And you have your own music playlist going. And now,
see, I had a Zanga before MySpace, and that was completely like every inch of that was completely customizable.
Really,
it was great.
And that's so. I tried to not switch. I remember, I don't want to switch. And then people just kept on yelling at me to switch because I was one of the very few people not using Facebook. So I ventured over to Facebook, and then MySpace disappeared. I guess bands still use it, though.
Yeah, it's kind of had its own little comeback of sorts. But
yeah, so if you're looking for good, for new music, MySpace is good for that. But I guess a lot of bands use it.
Cool.
So,
yeah, I think it's a legal system with this music. It's weird. I don't know how TikTok and everything can, you can just use whatever song you want. But if you're trying to make a montage for Facebook or Instagram, it'll take it down for some reason.
Even YouTube.
Yeah. For sure YouTube. Yeah. I don't understand it.
If you're not monetizing it, it's no different than playing it on the radio. You know what I mean? people are listening to it for free, but it's also getting listened to by people. So it's like the same thing.
Makes sense.
So Facebook, you just put it in a video on a post that you're not monetizing, you're not getting any money for. You'd think it'd be the same, but for whatever reason, it doesn't seem, Facebook doesn't seem to think so.
No, because you know why? They want you to use their music they have set, and so you may use it on your story mode. So you have just their stuff, and you have just what they're licensed to use. Probably protects their asses.
Mm. Doesn't their music stink, or is it the actual good music?
I mean, I'm going to be honest with you. For new music, in my opinion, most of it stinks if it's new. Most of it. Now, Snoop, Dr. Dre, Eminem, and Ice Cube came out with a new song, and it's actually pretty sweet.
Is it on Facebook?
It is. I actually shared the link for YouTube. It's YouTube. It's like Here We Come or Here We Go or something like that.
Well, don't play that one because I am not paying for Snoop's.
No, I'm telling people to check it out. So I don't think Snoop will be mad at me for that. They're bringing back Death Row Records. I'm so pumped, dude. I'm so ready for some good new music to come out. And I hope that they can help with that. Speaking of good new stuff, you guys, Jeff Fett posted this picture of a room that he just totally redid the floor. And he said, he posted the picture, and he actually, I couldn't find the one of the completed floor, but you see it's a cross, and he did it out of these carpeted squares. And I asked him in a comment, you know, why the cross floor, what's the significance? And he said he just felt like that's what belonged there. And I bet you anything, again, and Jeff, I believe he's sensitive. I mean, what he does with his boxes is absolutely phenomenal. And so I bet you he was tapping into something and felt like that. So it's good to listen to those intuitions and to lead with that. And now you guys have a beautiful room that we weren't able to access.
Oh, yeah. Everyone... Now, you wouldn't have fallen far through that floor, about like 2 feet, but it would have still been unpleasant.
It would have been very unpleasant and probably get some tetanus shots and all that fun stuff.
Yeah, because that stuff that was under there was old. So.
You know, that reminds me, Sean, you were talking about how Jeff is sensitive and he uses the spirit box like that. That's interesting because you and I were talking maybe like a week ago about when people use any kind of digital audio recorder or spirit box, or whatever, if they're holding it, they're sort of like a lightning rod or an antenna. And in a sense, aren't they channeling? Because we were talking about that when we were also discussing the Ouija board stuff. Like, if you're letting some kind of energy come through you in order to move the planchet on the board, and say you blindfold yourself or whatever it is that you're doing, then you're channeling. So it's kind of weird. Like, if you're standing there and you're asking questions and you're asking some kind of spirit or presence to come in and respond, where are they getting that energy? How are they answering? Are they answering through you? Are they reading your thoughts? What's going on? So going back to your point, is Jeff channeling? I don't know. But I think that he is sensitive, probably, whether he wants to admit it or not.
And sidebar about Jeff Fent, one of my favorite people on this planet. There are some crazy things coming from Resident Undead that involve Jeff Fent. And that's the only tease I'm going to give because my goodness gracious, there's some interesting things afoot.
I'm curious now.
I don't know. Yeah.
That was my whole point.
Yeah, I don't know what you can tease about it.
How do I?
My only tease is Jeff is great. It's going to be cool.
Jeff is great, and I. You know, whenever I invite him to investigate, whenever I have like an empty space or something, it's usually like pretty short notice. And he's a busy guy. So I have yet to investigate with him. And it's like a bucket lister for me to investigate with Jeff. I mean, I have, with Ectovision, he was there with us at the Licking County Jail. But now, like, I'll film, though. It's different when you're not filming. It really is. So,
it's weird. Like, when you film and you're investigating at the same time, you got some challenges. Whereas if you're just walking around and investigating, you don't have those same challenges. But on the other hand, when you're filming and investigating at the same time, you've got much more ability to debunk or look at what you actually caught to see if it coincides with what you remember.
Mm-hmm.
That those are the benefits and pros and the cons.
So real quick, Melvin, we did not boot you. I don't know what happened. But Melvin Seaborn's here. He said he likes your cut. Thank you. So Melvin, no, you definitely did not say anything. But Melvin, I would love to challenge you to go and watch the new episode by Our Haunted Minds on the RCI, the location they just released.
FCI.
I said RCI. Oh, my God. I'm so sorry.
Blasphemy.
Jeez. That's so bad, though. I'm sorry. I'm sorry to all of Resident Undead. And all
I forgive you. I still want Dave mad at you.
I don't want Dave. I don't want anyone mad at me. I'm sorry about that. But
yeah, and Melvin, just back to Melvin. I have no idea. I know Facebook has been doing some really crappy stuff. Like I just found a part of Facebook that is apparently taking it upon themselves to moderate comments on our stuff. So they are hiding comments on their own now.
Oh,
apparently.
Yes, they are jerks. We can't even respond.
And Sony Music Entertainment has blocked our video.
What? Today?
That's what it says.
Oh, it's probably because I played that stupid TikTok.
Oh, we all.
Oh, TikTok. Facebook, learn to work with TikTok.
Come on, Sean.
Well, luckily it's still on YouTube.
I just saw what Melvin said.
That's why you got kicked. That's my fault. I'm sorry, guys. I played a TikTok and I ruined it.
Did you see what Melvin said, Dave?
Which he said part? He's viewed it 10 times already.
Oh, my goodness. Okay,
he's
thank
working
you.
On a review for it.
Our review's coming.
hopefully we did better this time around.
I don't remember him saying anything bad about last time.
No. Everything that he did was constructive and, like, perfect. So
Yeah. He usually... When he that's why I love his reviews, because he's honest and he's constructive about it. He doesn't say stuff just to dig on people. He doesn't also at the same token, he's not kissing someone's ass. He's being real and he's being but it's genuine. So it's not like offensive. At least
I kind of say it like he's honest in a nice way.
Yeah.
If that makes sense. He could be constructive mm-hmm. and honest in a nice way. I like his style, the way he interviews people and everything. He asks the hard questions, you know, those questions like where did that come from? You know, just right out of right field. Just like, man, have you done this before? He's good. Dave's been trying to sweet talk him over to the network since, oh, I don't know. How long? Since forever?
Since he did that review and our interview and stuff.
Yeah, you're still working on that, aren't you, Dave?
I can. Hey, Melvin. Well, are we doing this now? Yeah. Hey, come on over. Here's my sweet talking, Melvin. Come over and do some stuff for the network, because that would be excellent.
That was great. Just pop Dave up there. How could you say no to that sweet face? How could you say no to that sweet, sweet face?
Easily. I have to say it to myself every now and then.
Well, yeah, I'm sure Mara's used to saying no, but...
All day, every day.
So, yeah.
Oh,
sorry. I'm now going around and sharing the link to the YouTube channel since I got us booted off of Facebook.
Gotcha.
I think it's still live on Facebook, I think, but for whatever, I have no idea what it did with Melvin's comment, though. I can't even see that he actually commented on anything on Facebook.
Oh, yeah, it's still here.
It's here on the...
It's on our Paranormal podcast channel.
Oh, okay.
Let me check Ari Media. Let me check the Ari
Media. I know there wasn't anything on the media network that I could tell.
What are they? They don't... You can't freaking compliment somebody's haircut? Like, what's that? No, it's here on Ari Media, too. Whatever. That's stupid. Melvin, you're welcome anytime. Next time that happens, you can we'll get you on the show. You can come on and you can talk to us anytime and ask your excellent questions anytime. And you can do it live because F Facebook.
Yeah.
I'd like to do that.
If I didn't have such a relatively decent sized following for the media network on Facebook, I would completely scrap it and go to another platform. But yeah, it is what it is.
Oh. Trying to use a sexy velvet teddy bear voice on it. Yep, I heard it.
Wait, let me get to my where's my microphone?
Melvin.
Hey Melvin. I need you to come on over to the network. Do all your fancy things for me.
Amazing.
Don't eat it.
Melvin, we need your sexy questions.
Oh, it's one of those days, boys.
What did we start?
Here we go. Melvin, it's always good to have you, brother. Even though you get to live in the sunny California.
Yeah.
It's not so cold here anymore.
Not right now.
Oh, no.
Uh-oh.
Oh. I didn't mean to scare you, though.
Wait, me or Sean? Sean.
Probably me.
I give credit to Sean for that one.
That's probably my fault. I took it to the next level.
That means Sean has to do a show every week instead of every other week from now on.
Oh.
That's what that means. That's what you get.
I feel like you need an adult.
Gosh.
I do need a doll.
Just save the clips from this video.
He touched you.
I was just going to say, save the clips from this video and bring it back up in like 10 years. Remind us all about it.
I'm sorry, that was bad.
Well,
I'm sorry. I should have used my long gone doll for it. That would have been a better example. Or Raggedy Ann.
Yeah, I still
feel like Melvin. Bringing it out with Eric is a bad influence on me, I think.
Maybe I'm being optimistic here, but I feel like Melvin's getting closer to coming on the network despite what he says. That's just me being optimistic. I feel like this is attractive.
Despite what he saw.
Yeah, despite what he does with his actions and his words, I think we still got him.
Some things have to get better before they get worse.
Exactly. You cannot heal unless you were wounded. Better. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. Right. That's true.
Yeah.
Oh, Lord. Scar everybody first. Bring him back later.
So, Sean, when you were at Fairfield County Infirmary and you did an investigation, what did you get?
That night, it was fairly quiet night all night. There was one bathroom where I had this like weird connection with this. There's a woman, felt like a woman was in this tub. It was like a tortured soul kind of feeling.
Okay, that made it so much. Yeah, okay. I went the wrong direction with that.
She was laying in the tub. I from what I gathered, what I felt, it's almost like maybe she committed suicide or something. Yeah.
If I can think about where the bathroom you're talking about is, we've had a woman like screaming in there multiple times.
Yeah. That wouldn't surprise me. And also we got some interaction in the it's a chicken coop area. Oh my god.
I thought you called my name.
No, I'm doing my show. Well, now why don't you come and say hi? Come on camera, everybody, meet Dakota. This is my youngest daughter.
Hey, I know Dakota. Today.
Okay, thanks for interrupting. That was very nice of you.
Well, I thought I heard you say my name because I was watching my talent and you were on the topic. And I thought you
called
my name.
Well, I'm sorry I didn't. Thanks for checking.
I don't know. You said hi to him. I was like, I don't know.
Dakota Gilmore, everybody. Love Cameo. You, sweetheart. She's skipping the crap out of me, though. Because I gave your headphones, and I don't expect someone to actually come down here and like talk to me. But I heard her through the mic. That was weird. But it wasn't.
It just could be worse. She's out of nowhere. It could be.
He says in my new book,
well, the doors kept opening.
You should trust your instincts.
Go for it.
This is crazy, isn't it?
I knew it.
That was a great time.
Into the abyss. Wait, wrong show.
No, that's the segment. Into the abyss. Brian's gonna give a spiel, but I love that transition.
You're that is sweet. It was
sweet. You're getting good at this, brother.
I knew it as soon as you opened your mouth. I knew.
I know it's crazy. this time, it's gonna be a three panel. How exciting is that?
Oh. Three panel.
It's just all three of you. So.
Oh, really?
Yes, but we're going to try shortish answers like it's supposed to be. 13 fast fire questions. You got to answer them as quickly and as thoroughly as possible. This time, no one's face is being enlarged, and Sean gets to play as well. How exciting is that?
Oh, all right. That's
all right.
Okay.
We'll do Dave, Eric, Sean.
Oh, he's on us, guys.
I know. You guys are wild. I'll give you number one and number 13 as a reference point. You guys ready?
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And now truly, all eyes are on you guys. Number one, again, Dave, Eric, Sean. Number one, scariest moment at Fairfield Infirmary.
Being stepped into by a possible voodoo priestess.
Finding Dave on the ground there.
After voodoo priestess.
After voodoo priestess.
Now Sean.
Rapid fire.
I didn't have an experience like that. My scariest experience was just I had a moment where I didn't realize I was alone, and because I tend to wander, you know, and when I wandered, everyone wandered to another floor, and I didn't realize that I was completely by myself on this floor. I got a little bit spooked.
Rapid fire.
Yeah. Most wild investigation you've been on?
Actually, probably it was years ago at the West Virginia Pen in Moundsville. Had some crazy stuff there. I don't know if I go into it or not. Not for rapid fire. I'll save it.
All right. Aside from Dave's experience, that investigation. Sean and I had a private investigation one time where things got wild. Cameras moved on their own. Voices disembodied. Multiple voices captured on different cameras. They were the same. Very wild. Full sentences. Crazy, crazy, crazy stuff. House shook. House literally shook. Okay.
Like, it was weird. Like,
rapid fire.
Mine is that same investigation with Eric. Yeah, it can't be that whole house. The whole house.
You got to pick another.
It's got to be a different one.
It's got to be a different one. Oh, fine. You know what? Our investigation at Hinsdale House, that noise that you and me, Brian, that noise that we captured outside, and then we got response to shaving the haircut.
Our haunted minds is such a beautiful thing. What's your favorite part of our haunted minds?
Being able to branch off and do the experiments.
I enjoy the freedom to try anything we want to try, and take suggestions, and pretty much anything can happen, and knowing that.
I like watching them. That's all I get to do, and I like it.
Worst injury on a paranormal investigation?
Well, there will be a Resident Undead episode at the Billy Creek Village in Rockville, Indiana, just a hop, skip, and stone throw away from the Indiana State Sanatorium. Wasn't on film, but the old wooden stairs outside one of the buildings were very wet, and my big self very much so slipped going down them.
Oh.
And landed spine first on them. So,
does it have to be my injury or someone else's?
Both.
Okay, on an investigation, I had somebody break their foot at the Agora.
I remember you telling me that.
So that was, but my own personal, it would be a tie between Fairfield wearing that stupid harness. I thought my gut was going to explode, and probably going to Hillview Manor and getting scratched on my neck.
My turn?
Oh yeah, I'm rapid fire. Boom, boom, boom.
I know you had to
like, like Rocky.
I'm still trying to think. Like my worst, I don't know. Yeah, it might be that dent that's on my leg from Fairfield. I'm trying to think what other injuries I've had on an investigation. I think that's it, because that hurt it bad.
What happened?
I was in the top floor of Fairfield, and there's a big cast iron something at the end of the hallway or the room, and I knocked my shin into it, and there's still a dent in my shin
to this day.
To this day, it's like indented.
Hey, I have a dent in my shin from high school track from a discus still. So.
Yeah, see.
13 years later, or still.
I thought it was going to be a hurdle or something. It's a discus. Oh my gosh.
Discus straight to the bone, baby.
What is the key to success when coming up with new paranormal techniques?
I would say the key to success when it comes to what we do is trying to come up with different scenarios and experiments that will not only garner responses from possibly intelligent spirits or possibly intelligent haunting, but also making it so it's fun for the people who are going to watch it.
Mm.
Okay, I like Dave's response about having it fun for people watching it. But as far as what is successful, you never know until you try something. You have all these theories, and you want to put them to the test, but you don't know what experiment is going to be successful and which one won't be. At one time, nobody thought to use a digital audio recorder or an EMF detector, and then just one day, everybody was doing it. Thank you, Ray. I will shut up right now because actually that's all I've got to say on the matter. It really is just pretty much unknown what makes you successful, and your creativity is probably the key, I would say. Definitely. That.
Especially since every location is different. So what's successful somewhere else is not going to be successful at another place, because it could be, whether if it's the difference between a hospital and a jail, or even if it's two different jails or two different hospitals, it's different spirits, different personalities, different situations. So what's successful in one place won't necessarily be successful in another.
Best way to pull off an amazing paracon.
Have great people involved.
Man, that is a great, short, concise answer. I would say hire Addy Gaddis and let her just do what she does, and actually Adam too. I mean, he's a great guy, and he literally does everything he can for everyone who's there and who's not there. And when you're there, he makes sure of this. He makes sure everybody feels welcome, and you feel like you're a big part of the success of anything that he does, or he's a part of, I'll say. So I would certainly say that kind of just says what Dave just said, but in a long way, so that I could sound original.
Yeah, definitely. My response. Definitely, though, right? Good leadership, good planning, and good advertising.
Oh my gosh, Sean is on a roll. Jeez.
All right. Melvin has motivated me. Melvin, there you go.
I'm impressed, Melvin. You did a good job. Now, what is the favorite quality of the other two people here? So, for example, Dave, you would give your favorite qualities of Eric and Sean, and so on and so forth.
I get open mic time. Yay. Eric.
Yeah, talk to him, Dave. Talk to him.
Eric. And done. Sean, I love you.
Oh. Surprise.
Well, they heard my dogs.
Anyway, Eric is Eric's great partner. I couldn't have asked for anything better when we were starting this project. Sean, excellent friend, always gets back to me in a timely manner, always makes sure things still are rolling. I appreciate the both of them.
Thank you.
Brian, you're great also.
Dave, I think you're the best drone pilot that's ever lived and ever will live. I think you're extremely talented and a phenomenal investigator, and I can tell that you're passionate about everything that you do. Also, I feel like you're a wonderful friend, and you've always got my back, and it means so much to me. Sean, I feel like you as an investigator are super sensitive, and I love that you are so passionate about what's going on as far as the feelings are concerned, and you're always thinking about the spirits. And when you ask questions, it comes out very clearly, because you're like, I want to hear your story. I love that about you. I think you're a phenomenal investigator. You're very talented with your approach, because you don't just ask stupid questions like, what's your favorite color? I mean, you're out to get the answers that are meaningful, and I love that about you. And Brian, I like your questions so far.
Man,
my heart's happy.
Yeah, how are you gonna follow that up, Sean? Man, we might have to end on a high note here or something.
Well, I'll tell you what. I'm with Eric. Eric is an amazing leader. When we were in Ectovision, everything he does is self-taught. He's extremely talented in everything he does. Everything he touches, he puts 150% into it, and he's thoughtful of literally everybody, whether if it's a colleague, a spirit, or whomever. He's thinking of the other person before himself. Wooliver, another great leader. He's brought RU Media. We've been here since day one, and it's been awesome watching it grow, and it's been awesome being a part of it, and I'm excited for the other projects we got going on. It's just, and again, very talented with editing and everything that he does. And Brian, man, I have to again bring up, man, your positivity, man. You bring the love and you keep the love coming no matter what, no matter how stressed out you are, brother. You are keeping it, you're keeping it positive, and I love that about you.
Thank you, guys. Dave, I love how you're transparent in everything you do, whether it's the stories that you share, and even in your planning and execution of all these different projects, it's transparent how much you actually care and how much you put your heart into every project. And there's a lot of them that goes on, and right. You actually overseeing it. It's transparent that you actually care and that you're doing a lot. And Eric, that's kind of the same thing with you, though it's not as transparent because you make everything look so easy, and all the edits and all the projects just look so polished. It's the things that people don't see, and it's the hours that took you to learn it, as well as the hours and then the hours that you didn't think were going to be there, but then show up. Mm-hmm. And clearly it's your passion and hard work that some people don't see. And that's one of the things that I admire about you the most. And Shawn, it's just that you're caring and loving, and behind everything that you do is always a foundation of love and caring. And you can see that in anything you do, even if it's just a podcast or reaching out to someone or just being there for someone, it's always quality.
Thank you.
Oh, gosh. No. Number eight. Number eight. I'm so sorry, guys. What do you do when you feel, Eric used the word whipped. What do you do when you feel whipped or wiped out when there's no activity occurring in an investigation? Whip. Yeah.
Like in terms of actually like
on investigation? Yeah. Well, like Fairfield, the first part, not a lot's happening. What do you do, like, for yourself and your team? Like, how do you keep motivated?
You just gotta regroup, try to plan something else out just on the fly. It's frustrating when things don't go exactly how you need them to go, but all you really need to do is just take a step back and reevaluate, and then move forward how best you can. There's no reason to get upset or anything like that. Things happen. There's always another plan. So.
Okay. So Dave's much better that than I am. Cause what I tend to do is I like to smash things or just raise a fit. But he's been sort of like a grounding source of energy for me. If you want to say that, he'll calm me down. He'll say, dude, let's just take a step back for a second. Let's go take a break. Let's get something to drink. Let's talk about it. And he is right. It works. You just got to calm down.
That definitely, that's pretty much what I do too. I mean, you get, you feel yourself get frustrated, worn out, whatever. So you just got to go reset. Something's not working. There's a reason. So you just got to find a new set, new intentions, and hopefully come up with something, you know, new and better.
You three have been a part of, a big part of teams, whether you were the leader or just like a pivotal part of it. And, you know, for all the teams that are just starting out, how do you cultivate that team spirit or that team like family attitude or mentality? How do you cultivate that culture of a paranormal team?
To be completely open and honest with one another. If there's, you know, a chain is only as good as its weakest link. Mm. You know, so I would say just surround yourself with as good of people as you can, like-minded as possible, even if you don't have people that agree with you, but just try to bring it together and understand each other, whether you agree or not. You're here for one goal. So just open, honest, get the job done.
Yeah. So no one agrees on every little detail, but as a leader, you should always try to put people in roles that allows them to play to their strengths. And as far as the family aspect is concerned, it comes naturally when you respect one another, when you give everybody an opportunity to be a part of the contributions that go into having a team. As soon as they feel as though they're heard, their voices are heard, they become a valued member of the group, they'll feel that way. Then the family part comes natural.
Yeah, I mean, definitely, I mean, you've got to, everyone needs to feel like they're a part of it. Everyone needs to feel like they are important, mm-hmm. and everyone needs to help. And a good person to go to for advice on this is actually Brian Mersault. He does an amazing job.
Thank you. You guys talk a lot about investigating techniques. You're even creating new ones. Even the ones that you didn't create, what's your favorite investigating technique to do?
Probably just a good old-fashioned EVP session.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I'd have to agree with that. EVP sessions are time-tested, and they do get you the results that you're looking for most of the time.
I think, I mean, that's the easiest. Not easiest, that's the wrong word. That's going, just keeping it basic and simple, like the EVP session or a simple conversation. Or you can, if you're lucky, Eric might even dance for you. And it's amazing.
I've done it.
Yeah, it
works.
Stuff like that works. It does.
Everything, you'd be surprised at what works. Mm-hmm. I know this is rapid fire session. Let's put a pin in that. Come back to it.
Oh, my bad.
Eric dances for food these days.
I did not make him dance for ribs.
Yeah.
I just invited him over. We wanted to hang out. I'm like, dude, I'll make some ribs. And he brought in some fancy sodas, and it was beautiful.
And Sean was saying how clothing was optional in the dance, and that's when I had to excuse myself from the conversation.
Oh, that's chicken.
What is the correct way to get the most out of constructive criticism?
The correct way to get the most out of constructive criticism.
First of all, to get the most. So if you're receiving it,
mm-hmm.
you need to first take it just as that. It's a learning opportunity. And take it as that. Don't get offended. And next time, use the new information that you've learned to make your work better.
Yeah, that goes straight back to Melvin with Unexplained Possibilities and his review of the pilot of Our Haunted Mind, so to speak. Obviously, he didn't say anything negative or anything like that, but just the constructive criticism is enough to get us moving forwards where we can be a better version of ourselves the next time we go to do this. So, I mean, just it's not worth getting mad over. If you're getting mad over constructive criticism, you don't need to be doing whatever it is you're doing.
Yeah.
So
this will sound a little pretentious, but I'll say it in spite of that. There's things to consider. You got to consider the source, the tone, and the person who's giving the advice, what their end goal is. Sure. So if they are coming at you with a bunch of suggestions and ideas that are absolutely out of right field, you need to be able to politely identify that and just thank you. But when there's something, honestly, that somebody's telling you that can really help you to become a better version of yourself, like Dave just said, then you have to also consider that as well. And if you don't, you never will become a better version of yourself. Your product or whatever it is, your goal, whatever it is you're trying to achieve, it'll never get any better than what you are right now. You become stagnant in that sense.
Okay.
We shook it up on you there.
We did.
Reverse order.
And I want to add one more thing to it, because Eric just reminded me of a saying that my 12-year-old son says. Everyone has buttholes. Our opinions are like buttholes. Everyone's got one and they all stink. That's what he says.
There you go.
I thought only some of them stink.
Mine smells like roses, boo boo.
That's his thing. But sometimes people are just being jerks, but you just take it as that.
Now, water, speaking of smelly butts, that's our butts on long car rides. You guys understand what I'm saying. How do you motivate yourself to drive an extreme amount of time for an investigation?
I know that I'm coming home to my beautiful wife. that motivates me to get on the road, get going. And I listen to music to get myself in a good headspace. And then I just go.
Okay, so on the way there, what motivates me to get there, I would say, is seeing everybody, greetings, catching up, all the fun that we have, the opportunity to actually experience something that a lot of people will go their whole lives without ever having a chance to experience. And then knowing that if I'm, say I'm with Resident Undead, the product that comes out after that, you know, the video that's made, all the stuff that we get to see our lives captured and then shared with the world. Yeah, same thing. Yeah.
I'm just saying. That's a pretty cool product you guys came out with.
Oh, I appreciate that. It's all that. It's being able to share that with everybody. And on the way home, I look forward to my empty bed. And nobody to love me. So
not even a dog. No, I'm kidding.
Dang.
But you know what? A nice peaceful bed is sometimes very nice to have as a father of three and a husband of 15 years. But I do. That's what motivates me to get home. Loud music, like Wooliver. If I start getting sleepy, some sort of caffeinated substance, maybe probably a drink. Maybe, I don't know. But lots of caffeine, loud music. And when I go in there, I'm just motivated to get there. I'm excited to see friends, family. I'm excited for the experiences that are about to come. It's like a nervous excitement, you know, because mm-hmm. you never know.
Yeah.
Now, this is number 13. You all have garnered beautiful paranormal communities, you know, through all the different projects and shows and everything you've been on. This isn't just like a, you know, little message to our haunted minds. This is, if there was a collective of every single paranormal project or team that you've worked with or been on or been a part of or created, so that entire paranormal community that you garnered over the years, it's one message you want to give them. If hypothetically they were all here, oh guys, we love your work, this, that, it's one message.
Well, one message that I would give to the community that's around us is just simply thank you for being here. This was just an idea. I remember it was 3 or 4 years ago now for the RU Media Network, much longer for Resident Undead. But the outpouring of love and just loving the product, loving us, helping get this media network off the ground, keeping it going. That's just the best that I could possibly say is thank you to everyone and know that we love you for everything.
Okay, so Dave stole mine, like word for word. So I'm just going to have to come up with something different. If it wasn't thank you that I would say to everybody, I think I would then offer advice, and I would say, stay true to yourselves and continue to help others learn and just keep doing the research, keep doing what you're doing in general. That's probably where I would end it. Stay positive.
Stay
positive. If I didn't say that.
Stay positive and keep learning.
Keep learning. And actually, my quote on my Facebook page is, never stop learning. The moment you stop learning is the moment you lose. And that is what I would pass on as well. As well as a big, serious, like, thank you to everyone who has had me be a part of their projects, teams, and events, and everything else that have brought me down this amazing path and if you want to call this a career, my paranormal career, it's been absolutely amazing. It really has been. I mean, with the podcast, with Activision, with Ghost Hunt for Brian, being, I mean, just so much. I mean, It's brought me in so many different things. I mean, I've had stories published in books, man, and it's just like, I never thought any of this would ever happen. I never thought I would be in a YouTube video with more than a view. So, I mean, it's just so, it's been so amazing. And totally, when I got into paranormal, it is not what I expected at all. And it's been an amazing, amazing journey. So I want to seriously thank everyone, but really push that. Don't stop learning. You are not done learning. I don't care how smart you are. You are not done learning because life is not over yet. No, at that point, are you done learning? And even at that point, you're going to learn what's next. So you never stop.
That's cool, Sean. You took mine and Dave's answer and you just kind of combined them.
What?
Very sly.
Well, congratulations, everyone. We just escaped and we made it through the abyss. So taking the pin off. Yeah. Take the pin off. Eric, what's with you in this dancing? You know?
Oh, okay. So, Sean learned really early on, during investigations, I like to try different things. And one thing that I told him in private, away from everybody else, was that we would get a lot of interaction when we were being ourselves, making jokes and goofing off. But prior to that, my first time goofing off in front of him, I hadn't told him. We were at the Ohio State Reformatory where I commenced cutting a jig. I was just dancing around trying to get Bobby, who was helping me with the cords, you know, with the power cords. We were trying to stretch out all these cords and everything. And Sean, who was holding his digital audio recorder at the time, and just kind of watching me dumbfounded. He goes, "What did I get myself into?" Kind of look on his face. And it worked even then.
You got an EVP.
Yes, it works a lot. And you're just being yourself, and you're trying to, I guess, like, make yourself more approachable. And however you do it. With me, it was always just making myself look like an idiot, which was easy. That came natural. So anytime I did anything like that, I just noticed that we would get more interaction. So that was the whole mindset behind that.
Well, Eric is a comedian.
Yeah, I used to be.
He still is. He's a funny guy. And he's very personable, and he makes that part of the investigation very easy.
I appreciate that,
Al. Yeah. Our downtime between segments for RU and Haunted Minds is not downtime when Eric's there.
Your belly's probably hurting from laughing.
Most of the time.
Yeah, even when I'm mad, it's probably a little funny, I'll say. And I'm not trying to be, but I just say some of the most ridiculous stuff. And it's literally what's coming to my head, like taking a camera and smashing it. I'll say it colorfully, and I think it just dresses up the occasion. So
that's awesome. And Dave, there was Melvin asked, just to get the spoilers off of it, when you get adversity in the paranormal field, you're almost like down for the count. But you almost get like a second wind and you like come back. It's almost like a fighter in a boxing ring, like Tyson Fury getting knocked down and coming back to life out of nowhere. Where did you get like that courage or that oomph to get back in the game?
Yeah, I'm looking at Melvin's comment up there. For that particular instance, and I won't dive into it too heavy, but I think I had mentioned before we even went on live, it was just a matter of we needed to move forward. There wasn't a way in my brain that this wasn't going to happen still. And I think I felt like I owed it not only to myself, but to the particular entities that were trying to reach me by phone, if you will. Mm-hmm. At least the one from the episode, you know, spoiler alert, if you haven't seen it. If you haven't seen it, go watch it. there was a spirit who had a possible like a family-esque like spirit guide, I guess. And we believe I had made a connection with him years previous at Fairfield County Infirmary, the very first time any of us had ever been there. And then somehow this time around, because I had been at FCI from, you know, the time Adam got it, doing random work, doing yard work, whatever else. So it may have been a thing where I've continued to connect with this person without realizing it. This time, I guess he just really wanted that connection and couldn't find a way to do it, but she apparently did. So I felt like not only do I owe it to myself to keep going, but I owed it to this person also who was trying to reach me, to be able to have that connection and have that moment. So pretty special to keep moving forward instead of calling it a night.
Yeah. Sure. I think even if it's like, as long as it's not like serious danger, like there's a consensus that there's something negative or sinister there and, you know, trying to harm you, this is that, obviously there's gray lines and when you should leave. But one of the things that, you know, just like you're saying, like you owe it to these, I mean, like yourself and the teammates and everything, but also some people forget that you're going there to connect with spirits, see if they need anything, if we can help them get a message across, you know, just to have some kind of communication, because a lot of these spirits, they don't have the opportunity to communicate with people. And I think reminding people why we're there to help, we're there to create these memories, because, and even going back to what Eric said, what if you never come back here? You know, like you drive 2 hours, it's West Virginia, you know, Moundsville, you might never come back here. And this is your opportunity to help the spirits there, to make the memories with the friends there that you have and everything. Some people just get spooked and want to, you know, cut out, but this is the time to be brave because you're there to help.
Mm-hmm. Definitely. Yeah, I have a question. First of all, I want to say this. You guys released this video 5 days ago and you already have 27,000 views. That's amazing. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Thank you.
That shows how good it is. I mean, if you haven't gone and seen it, guys, go check it out. And I have a direct question about your experience, Dave. When you were having your experience, do you remember anything? Like, do you remember any dreams, any thoughts, anything like that while you were, I don't know, were you unconscious or whatever state you were
in? Oh, yeah, I was passed out. I can't recall anything during that time. I pretty much have the moments before, which we were setting up for the solo sessions. I was actually I was in the jail cell at FCI setting up for mine. That's where I was originally going to do it. But of course that didn't pan out and I ended up just in the hallway. I don't know, it just went dark so fast. I don't remember anything during that point. When I came back, it was a quick, like, earth-spinning type of moment. Okay. But there wasn't really much of anything that I could recall during it.
Okay. That kind of makes sense. I was just kind of curious because of the situation. And also for those that may be wondering, when you passed out, could it have been from heat exhaustion? Were you really hot? Or
it wasn't really super hot by that point. I'm just a sweaty person. Okay. You know, big guys sweat. Yeah. But by the time we got to that point, it had cooled off outside enough to where, you know, when we were going in and out, breezes were coming in and out of the building. So it wasn't really that much. It was just mostly just me moving around. So I don't think it was anything to do with the heat or anything like that. And I've been drinking water all day, so I don't think it had anything to do with that. It really just felt like this was something that, one, I never thought I would experience.
Right.
It was just crazy.
Right. I just felt like I should ask because I know that there's probably people thinking it. So that's why I wanted to kind of nip that in the bud. Because, I mean, I know you guys personally, and I know if you say and you present something in a video, you guys are not going to put something in a video that's not factual. I know I could trust you guys with that. But someone else, you know, they might think, hey, what if he was just hot and he just passed out from being hot? And then they, you know, so I just want to nip that in the bud because I didn't
think. I'll be, to be fair and honest and upfront about it, when we were there, I do believe that it wasn't off the table in the moment. That's why I was running to get the water downstairs. Yeah. We had no idea what had happened. Becca had we rely heavily on Becca for that sort of like that spiritual guidance, and she had just gotten hit by something, and then Dave walked into it. But even with that, she didn't want to risk Dave's health based on what she was feeling in the moment, because she right. does. She has two different mindsets on an investigation. She's got that grounded kind of what's the word I'm looking for? I don't want to say skeptical mindset, but it's more like a physical, like what conventionally could have caused Dave to fall down. But then she's got this ability that allows her to see what spiritually could have happened here. And since she had just experienced that as well, you know, she was very much thinking that it could be this voodoo spirit priestess who was kind of acting as a liaison between the spirit that actually wanted to communicate with Dave and Dave himself, if that makes sense.
Yeah, it does. And actually, Melvin asked about the voodoo. It says, if that were a mambo, a voodoo priestess, communication with her probably could have been amplified by asking Papa Legba to open gates. Someone indicated in voodoo would need to do that, though. That's taking it to another level. You're right, Melvin. I don't know if Eric or David are you guys familiar with Papa Legba and...
I know of it, but I'm definitely not initiated into voodoo, so.
Yeah, me.
Yeah. I mean, but it's interesting, though, because Becca did tell you, David, to use your sweat that you're using to wipe off from your, that you're using to wipe off from your forehead. So that, I mean, that's kind of, I don't know if it's kind of the same thing, but she was giving them that. To use it's kind of like putting that in front of the side of the cure, use something with my energy on it to make it easier to communicate with me.
Gosh, Sean.
What do I do?
Constructive criticism.
Initiated, not indicated. Oh, my bad. Melvin's always catching me on that. Thanks, Melvin. I appreciate that. Would you ever consider a weekend lockdown at that place?
Which weekend?
Right. Didn't you guys do a 2-day investigation for this?
We did. Before? We did, but I slept in the White House, and I think.
And I went home.
Yeah, first night you went home. I don't know if you went home second night, though. Did you?
Yeah, I did. Okay. And then I came back on Sunday.
Okay.
Oh, wow. So, no, you stayed at the White House. That's the house that's on the property. I have never been in that house. I hear that house.
Me neither.
Yeah, it's
got some weird stuff in it.
Yeah, I've never had anything really profound happen to me personally in the White House, but I've never conducted an investigation there, and I've not been there for very much. At you know, each time I've been there, mostly I'm just there to crash after you know, investigating or. This last time it was after our investigation with RU. I went back there, crashed both nights. But you're so tired. I think it would take a train to wake you up after all the work we do.
I don't know. When we were at the Hensel House, Brian got this bright idea of taking a REM pod. You know the vent that's on the floor, the top floor or the ceiling going down to the living room? Mm. Yeah, he got the bright idea to put it right there. And that thing went off all night long.
He was like,
go get it. I was like, no, man, you're the one that set it up. You need to get it.
Regretting that decision.
Neither of us wanted to do it.
I can say that I properly had enough fluids with, like, caffeine and water. So, like, I should have been fine. I definitely hit a wall, the earliest wall I've ever hit at that place, and I like over caffeinated and drank enough water, so like it wouldn't have been like caffeine overdose like fatigue. I don't know why I felt so tired, and there was no chance I was going up there to turn that REM pod off. I said, I'm just sleeping. There's no, I don't even want to look at the time. It's probably 3 o'clock. No thanks.
Yeah, that was an interesting night because we were all drained that night. It was so, but yeah, but even still though, with that, the, neither of us wanted to get up because we knew, we knew what was making it go off. There's no reason, no logical reason for that thing to be going off the way that it was. So we were both like, I was just like, I don't know. I was just so drained and tired. I didn't want to get up. I was on a couch and wrapped up in my sleeping bag. And like when you're a round guy like myself, like it's not that easy to get in and out of a sleeping bag. And I was comfy, and I didn't want whatever was having fun. And I was sleeping in between the beeps. I was okay. And besides that, I wasn't driving home.
Yeah, so you should have went up there and did it. You didn't care about the beep. Dang you, Sean.
I was stuck.
When I stayed at Hinsdale House, I slept up there. So remember, I would have turned it off for you.
Yeah, you did. You slept up there. Was that with us? Or
yeah.
Okay. Then we were like, I was like, I'm not sleeping in that house. There's supposed to be something demonic in there. Little did I know that the land there was more haunted than the house itself.
Yeah, so you made another bad life choice there, you see?
it was interesting. It was an interesting night. Sleep, that's for sure. Now I want to talk a little bit about the event. We're getting close to the top of the hour, and so I want to make sure we talk about this, because Adam puts together these cons, and he always makes sure that the monies that are raised goes to excellent causes. And it's not just for the benefit of the location or himself. So I know who some of these people are in this picture, and I actually think I know who all of them are, but maybe not everybody knows. So there's two goofy guys in the back there.
Hey.
We know you guys, right? So then we have Adam, and I see Chris Musgrove. Who's the other Chris? Spelled K.
That'd be Chris Williams.
Yeah.
She hails from Ghost Hunters back in the day. I think maybe Ghost Hunters International as well. And just recently has done a few episodes of the new old Ghost Hunters.
What's it called? The reunion kind of show that they're doing?
Yeah, they brought the original cast back instead of the craziness that happened a couple years ago.
Who's Kalani?
Kalani Smith. He is a TikTok ghost hunter. He's got quite the following. Very interesting videos that he puts out. He has a lot of fun doing what he does. He has a very cool personality. He's just out there doing things that he loves. So, yeah, Kalani, I think it's Kalani Ghost Hunter on TikTok.
CJ.
CJ is a, I think it's Faison. Is that how you say his last name?
I think so.
Okay. He's a YouTube guy too. He does a lot of racing. I don't remember what the exact title of his racing is, but he's got a really cool car. He does really well, a lot of cool content with that, and he does a lot of ghost hunting, paranormal investigations as well. So
he actually has a very, very successful YouTube channel.
Yep.
And
Jael.
Jael, I'm sorry, my ticker is covering her name.
Jael DePardo. She was from Destination Truth back in the day with Josh Gates. There was a show that she did, I believe, with Jack Osborne called like Haunted Highways. And then she was also a part of Ben Hansen's Factor Fake Paranormal Files.
Nice.
So nice lineup of people coming.
Oh, yeah.
We're excited for it. We're excited for everybody to get to meet everyone and have a good time.
Yeah, so what we're going to do as part of the event is allow the opportunity for Chris and Jael to fight over me, and whoever wins, wins. I am not, like, I don't have a dog in the fight, guys. Whatever happens, happens.
You got to do the paranormal hide and seek there.
Well, maybe, maybe. That's an idea. I'm not going to say no to anything. Like I said, I'm not getting involved. I don't want to see the ladies fight, but if they have to, whatevs. You know, it's I'm going cash. That's what I'm doing.
I'll jump in there and fight them.
Brian, Melvin asked a question. After seeing a Fairfield County Infirmary investigation and seeing the experiences Eric and David had, if you were to investigate them, would you want a similar experience?
I don't think you would want a similar experience to Dave. I'm not sure if there's...
Honestly, I wouldn't wish that on anybody. Just from when it happened, it was a pretty scary thing. Looking back on it now, obviously, with hindsight.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was a pretty cool experience, but I don't want that to happen to anybody.
Yeah, I mean, like, you want to tread the water. Like, you want to tread the gray line, you know what I mean? You know, because, like, you want a lot of activity, but then, of course, if it gets out of hand, as a leader, you're like, eh, what do you do? Just, like, from, like, even my team, like, I have no Ouija boards. I know it's all, like, you know, there's a huge debate or whatever. I don't need that kind of energy with my team. It's just personal preference. I would prefer to have that kind of communication, just not in that way. I'd like want that level of communication and that, I don't know, like that kind of activity, but not necessarily in that form. Kind of like if there's a lot of energy and you heard some knocks on the wall, that'd be great. Like more knock responses, less back scratches and, you know, people blacking out, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. But
positive and light.
Yeah. I mean, I don't know how it would differ. I mean, if that would happen, there'd just be more time, you know, taking that individual or myself outside. But I mean, yeah, I'd love that level of activity. It's just not that specific type of activity.
Yeah.
Right. Everybody wants that strength.
It's hard to judge. Yeah. It's hard to judge, especially when you're in the moment. I don't really, besides what we all talked about for the episode, well after the fact, I don't think anybody could be truly prepared for something like that.
Right.
To occur.
Yeah.
And like, who thinks that, you know, like who's going to.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's insane. No, there are some people though, they are looking for experiences like that. They want that.
The adrenaline junkies.
There's certain people there. That's like, I want to experience that. And it's just like, that's, to me, I don't know exactly like you said. Like, are you looking for just the adrenaline? I mean, if you're in this just for the adrenaline, I'm telling you right now, that is the wrong reason to be doing this. We all want to have thrills, right? But the thing is that what we do has serious, serious risks. An experience like David has is something that not only something he'll always remember, it'll always be a part of him, but spirit could end up attaching themselves and creating other issues further down the line. And so there's a lot of real risk. So what level of risk are you willing to take and do you really want? So you know what I'm saying? So
yeah, because that's why like in like the Your Paranormal, there's like the rules like no Ouija board and like no provoking and be respectful and be a professional, you know, that kind of stuff, because you don't want to getting a spirit upset or even the owners of the location. I mean, Adam will kick your ass. I mean, let alone spirits, you know.
I mean, other than that though, I mean, even David wasn't provoking when that happened.
Adrenaline junkie. Why would you?
And this is why you need shield and ground and use prayer, whatever it takes to keep stuff like that from happening. Do you do any of that, Dave?
It depends. I don't dive too heavy into it. Usually if we're going to film at a place that I know is super gnarly, I'll at least say my piece before I go in. I'll say my piece before we leave. Just, say, hey, you ain't coming with me. You don't have to go home, but you can't stay here,
but you have to stay here.
Yeah.
Right.
It just really depends on the investigation, the place that we're going to. Like if I were to go to, say, like a Pennhurst or something, that would be one of those where I'd be like, might carry one of those little orange pocket Bibles they used to give us when we walked out of middle school.
Actually, I keep a prayer book in my backpack. I've only had to use it once, but it's there, and it's for that one, blue moon type of situation. And it's important for things like that.
And we usually have Becca also, just to reiterate. So
definitely. I mean, if I was there, I would have been like, here, I would have been like taking my crystals in my pocket. I'd be like, here, hold on with this.
Yeah.
But here's some sage. No. But it would, none of that, honestly, if you don't believe in any of that, none of us can do anything for you. But it's just about finding that level. And that's what's so hard about all of this. There's no direct answer. There's no direct anything for anything that we do. That's why the risk is so great. There's just so much more that we don't know than what we do know. And I want to thank Melvin. He says, personally, I think you're all nuts, but you're helping bring answers to those questions of what, if anything, lies beyond.
Melvin needs to come out on an investigation sometime. Melvin, that's what needs to happen.
Melvin, I'll tell you what, I'm going to Arizona. Meet me somewhere. No, I don't know about time in that. Oh my goodness, we need to though. Melvin is such a good guy. One time he helped me with doing a special reading and connecting with angels, and it was such a neat experience. I want to do it again. And Melvin is just such a great, great guy, and I don't know. So yes, Melvin, you need to come out here. Not happening. What? What's not happening?
We'll take him on a haunted tour of Ohio. How about that?
Yeah. Melvin's like my wife. She says, you're all about risk and reward. There's so much risk. I don't see the reward. I say, listen, if something happens, that means there's an afterlife. And like, that's, a lot of people live with such, faith.
I still get to see your face.
Yeah. Yeah. I just think if your back gets scratched, at least that there is something. Like, how many people, like Eric said, go their whole life without actually not knowing?
All right, we'll have a barbecue.
Yeah, haunted barbecue.
Heck yes. Yep, we'll do it.
You don't get any of Sean's ribs unless you go on an investigation.
Yes. Spatulas and REM pods.
We, true though, but like with this, it's like your wife is a smart one. My wife is kind of the same way. She will not go on any investigations. She doesn't go anywhere with me. My kids actually have been to more locations with me than my wife. They've been to two now. Yesterday was the second. They were both jails. One, I took them to OSR for the Parapsycon last year. And then this year, just an impromptu little tour of a haunted Bryan jail yesterday, because I was... And then kind of in the neighborhood, drove a little bit of our way just to make that 3-hour drive worth my while. Fun. But it's so true though. There's to somebody that doesn't understand our passion in this, I could see. I mean, I had a coworker at an old job that when she found out what I did, she would see me and she had turned around and walked the opposite way. She would have nothing to do with me. She did not want to be in my space. She didn't want me in her space, is what it was, because she thought that I talked to demons.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
And that's so she thought by talking to me, it'd bring demons into her life.
Yeah.
And you know what? I respect that. But no matter how much I don't agree, it's just, but that's just because, right? It's just different beliefs. And so she needs to follow her boundaries, follow her gut instinct, and that's her gut instinct, so be it. And Melvin says, here's the thing with me. I don't need to see it or experience it to believe. Plus, you guys are already doing the hard work. I just sit back here and enjoy the results.
There you go.
Right? I mean, but hey, man, I mean, I'll tell you what. I was just at a location and you'll probably won't, unless I got something really good on a clip, you might see a small clip of what I do. I don't make documentaries. I just share. And I probably get like 10 views for the little clips I make. So, but it's all about sharing and spreading that story. Mm-hmm. Because spirit's trying to tell us something. They're telling us to share it. Because that's when I go out, I'm investigating. I'm asking. I want to share your story. So if spirit, I feel like, went out of its way to share something with me, I want to share it the best I can.
Mm-hmm. Now I know it's 9. Is the best thing to do YouTube, go to the search bar and type in Our Haunted Minds.
Yeah.
What you're thinking.
Yeah.
That's the message. Open up YouTube. Search bar. Our Haunted Minds.
That'll get you there. Yeah. Search it there. And then when you see that circle with the Our Haunted Minds logo on it, hit that. It'll take you right to our channel and our videos up there somewhere. You'll find it. You'll love it too.
I did just share the link in our comments, so it will show there. And do you guys link the Our Haunted Minds to the RU Media YouTube channel?
We do. And do we do it to the RU Media Network? Has a playlist on it, right?
Yeah.
Dave? It should now.
Yeah.
So awesome. And Melvin, I'm going to be looking for that review. I love your reviews. And I try to sneak in it and watch your show when I can. It's always informative. He asks the best questions. He really does.
I love listening to Melvin's shows.
Mm-hmm. So even though you're not on the RU Media Network, we're going to plug you, Melvin, because the Unexplained Possibilities is awesome, what you do. But I don't know what day it's on. I'm sorry. Can't plug it that well, but I can plug everyone.
Melvin just puts out stuff whenever he wants to, and it's just, when it's done, it's just, here you go, guys.
Yeah.
That's what Melvin does.
Definitely. Here we go. It's whenever I feel like it. That's the way to do it. That's the way to do it. Then you do it in your own time. No pressure. All right, but Melvin, if you ever want to come on the show, I know you announced a book coming out, brother. Let me know, let Brian know, let Wooliver know. We'll get you on all the shows. We'll even get you your own show.
Oh, dang.
As you guys can tell, we all love Melvin. So thank you for the continued support always, Melvin. I've known you now. Oh, man, for years. It's been a long time that we've been kind of in passing through the social media and paranormal. So it's been a pleasure. Thank you. And thank you, everyone else. And with that, guys, do you guys want to plug anything?
Sure. Like we all just said a gratuitous amount of times, go to YouTube and watch the newest episode of Our Haunted Minds from the Fairfield County Infirmary. That would be greatly appreciated. While you're over there on YouTube, it would be also greatly appreciated if you liked the video. If you went back and watched our first video from Madison Seminary, if you subscribed and hit the notification bell, that lets you know when we upload new videos.
Also, FCICon 2 coming up this weekend on June 11th. Special guests. You guys are going to love it. So many cool raffle items. Find us on, like I said, YouTube. Find the RU Media Network and our personal selves on Facebook and Instagram and those kind of things. I don't think I missed anything. Eric, is there anything I missed?
If we say anything else, I guess it would just be about Resident Undead. Make sure you're watching them guys. Us guys. Yes. Watch them. And oh, geez, Dave, you took all the good ones.
I know. It was just coming to my brain. I kept talking.
Did you talk about Are You Media Network?
And, a little.
Oh, wait. No, wait. Yeah. What? Do we have any bills coming?
Yeah, let's kick that we back have. Over to Dave. Okay. Yeah. For the RU Media Network, we did just recently acquire the Manifest Network also. You can find that on Facebook, the Manifest Division now. The Manifest Division RU Media Network on Facebook. They continue to host a lot of the shows that they were hosting previously on that page. We're working to try to get it seamlessly connected a little bit better. But yeah, whole slew of new shows that people can tune in and have fun with. Yeah, I think that's it. I think that's all the big news so far.
Awesome. Now, a little bit of house cleaning for Brian and I. 2 weeks from now is Father's Day. Yeah, so that's when our show would be. But I'm going to be busy with my family. I'm sure Brian's going to be busy with his family.
Yes.
So we are not going to have a show. However, guys, we have a very special show for you the following Sunday, where normally we would not have a show, but since we're missing, we're going to have a show. We have Dan Class coming on along with we're going to have Vicky back on. And so it's going to be great. They have some great new projects that we're going to talk about with the Hinsdale House. And they have helped us a lot. So we're happy to have them on. And that's the only reason why we're happy to have them on. It's an awesome location. Dan's an awesome guy. And Vicky does so much behind-the-scenes stuff for the paranormal community. Y'all would be surprised. Yeah, your jaws are dropped. You know what this woman does. She's just very – she doesn't talk about it. But so it's going to be a fun show. And we'll talk about it. So thank you, Dave and Eric, for coming on, man. It's always hanging out with both of you. Dave, I know we have a big project coming up too.
Yep. Hopefully we can get started on that soon.
Hopefully.
It's Mysteries of the Road. We're doing everything from a little bit of ghosties to a little bit of Bigfooties to a little bit of flying sky thingies. So
am I a part of this or not?
If you want to be. You want to be?
I keep forgetting to ask you.
Do you want to be?
What do you want me to do?
Whatever you want to do.
Okay. You can't really argue with that. That's awesome. Whatever I want to do. Cool. I'll be like the
now I'm even more excited.
I'm just gonna answer for Eric. He's gonna be part of it.
Okay.
And it's just
Eric, it's been decided.
For the first time, I've gotten even more podcast.
Yeah, Eric McGill. This literally is the first time anybody's finding out, including Dave.
Including Eric and Dave.
I'm so much more giddy about it now because I get to hang out with Eric more.
Nice.
Awesome.
Eric will talk about this.
All right.
Awesome, we have awesome things. I'm waiting to hear about a location still. Hopefully, fingers crossed, we'll hear back. If not, of course, we have backup plans to the backup plans.
Yes.
That would still be so cool. Oh my God. So, but so lots of cool stuff, guys. Make sure you're following RU Media Network. Make sure you're following Our Haunted Minds on YouTube. Go to YouTube.
More coming from Our Haunted Minds.
Hit the bell. Make sure you're following RU Media Network. Make sure you're following Resident Undead. And make sure you're following Our Haunted Minds. And also, while you're at it and you're looking up all these people, go and find Your Paranormal and find Brian's stuff because he has some great content. Where yeah, he's like, yeah, whatever. No, I'm plugging you because you
get away, compliments.
You want to find a way. You want ideas on how to build a team. You want ideas on whatever. He's got them, and he's got such a fun, positive way of doing it all. And you'll even get to see his frunk. His frunk. That's a front trunk of his Tesla. So
oh, that is not what I thought you said.
It's accurate.
So, but guys, as always, thank you for tuning in. Did we hit everything?
I think so.
Yeah. All right. Cool.
Yes, sir.
Awesome. Well, guys, I hope we got your week off started well. I hope. Yeah. That's gonna be my new thing. I hope we helped you start off your week in a fun.
He said something completely different.
What did I say?
I caught it too. Your week off great.
I don't know. I hope we get you. I hope we gave you a good start to your week, a good end to your weekend, a good start to your week. Everyone, we will see you 3 Sundays from now, the Sunday after Father's Day, and make sure to go to the FC Icon this weekend at Fairfield County Infirmary and support a good cause, support awesome people, and see awesome people. These events that they have, it's always like hanging out with family. It's always a good time. You will not be disappointed. And with that, everyone, hope you all have a good evening. And we see you next time. And I do not have the video ready.
Thank you, everyone. Good night.
Good night. Thanks for having us, guys.
Hey, thank you, guys.
Thank you. This paranormal adventure that we're all on, it connects us. This is our paranormal community. This is our paranormal podcast with your host, Sean Gilmore.
He's worked in the paranormal field for 10 years.
He was featured on the TV show Paranormal Survival that airs on Travel Channel.
His passion is creating parunity.
With your host, Brian Mercer.
He's worked in the paranormal field for 7 years.
He leads his own paranormal team.
He wants to help people start their paranormal adventure or grow their existing one. This is our paranormal adventure. This is our paranormal community. This is our paranormal podcast.
It's about supporting. It's about making parunity a real thing because we all need to support each other within our community. And that's what the show has always been about.